Welcome to Night Talks, the University of Florida College of Journalism and Communications talk show produced by students for students. I'm Alex Land, a freshman studying journalism and psychology, and today our guest is Charles Harris, the former Night Division Director at the University of Florida's College of Journalism and Communications, and most recently he was the CEO of the Central Florida Community Action Agency. Hi Charles, thank you for being here with us today.
Hi Alex, thanks for having me.
In 1978, you earned your bachelor's degree in advertising from the University of Florida. So what drove you to studying advertising? Was this always the plan?
No, it wasn't. I was a first-generation college student and had never actually been on a college campus itself. I was encouraged by others to apply for college. But when I came in, my first major was psychology. And honestly, it's because I didn't know anything else. I was just fishing around.
Right.
And I changed from psychology. I went to business. I was all over the place. And normally in your first 2 years, that's when you sort of feel your way around the different majors and opportunities and careers around that are available at the University of Florida. But in my junior year, my sophomore year, I decided that advertising would be a good major for me. And really it's because of the creativity involved with it. I thought that was an opportunity for me to express myself creatively. And I felt it was a good opportunity for me to establish a career.
Was it scary switching?
No, not at all. Because again, I was still doing my gen ed, you know, so again, I would take a class that would intrigue my interests.
Right.
Pick my interest and then say, okay, this sounds like something, and I would do a little research to see if this was an opportunity for a career for me. So it really wasn't. It was sort of fun to move around. but again, it reached a point my sophomore year where I really needed to focus on what I was going to do for the rest of my life.
Mm-hmm. Your first role with the University of Florida was Assistant Director of Minority Emissions in 1987. What was the state of minority emissions at the time, and what kind of work did this entail?
It really was a grant opportunity provided by, at that time, the Board of Regents, which was the governing body for all of the state university system. And they had provided grants to schools to bring in minority recruiters, because at that time, the whole system was trying to increase the number of minority students that were entering the system. The position actually entailed, I was actually Assistant Director of Minority Admissions, but it was for transfer students. So I actually went out to community colleges and recruited students for the University of Florida. And the idea was that a lot of the students that were having problems at UF, especially minority students, it was getting through that gen ed maze.
Mm-hmm.
But when they came to us with their AA degree, they had all those requirements completed. And at that time, they'd be able to go right into the major and have success. And back then, there were studies that showed that students that were native and transfer students, once they got into the junior year, that they performed pretty much at the same level there. So really it was an opportunity to go out and recruit minority students from the 28 community colleges that we have in the state of Florida. And at the time, the numbers were very low, which is the reason why they had the grants available. In fact, when I started at the University of North Florida, it was also on a grant opportunity provided by the Board of Regents that were trying to create some opportunities for increasing the number of minority students in the system.
What led you to getting that position?
Well, I was a recruiter as I mentioned, I started out recruiting at the University of North Florida, and then from there I went to the University of South Florida as a recruiter. And at that time, the director of minority recruiting for the University of Florida was Mr. John Boatwright. And Mr. Boatwright had met me out on one of these career fairs they have, where we have the table set up and mm-hmm. we're talking and everything. And he actually asked me, was I interested in coming back to the University of Florida and working up under him? I felt there was an opportunity for me because I always wanted to come back to UF. Mm-hmm. I had fond memories of being here as a student. So really, it was an opportunity for me that was offered to me to come in. And it was a new position. I was the first person in that position. When I left that position, the folks that came in after me, I sort of became the informal trainer for them because they would come to me and get advice mm-hmm. on how the program works and everything.
In 1989, you began working for the CJC's Minority Programs Office, which later became the Night Division. What is the Night Division? What's its mission? And how did that evolve over time?
There was a need to put more emphasis and put more structure into a program that would encourage minority students to come into the college and be successful in college. So it wasn't just recruiting the students, but it was helping them to graduate and making sure that the retention numbers stayed high. So it was a minority program. It was a 5-year grant, and it was very aggressive in that we said that we would go out and recruit students and bring them into the college and, again, help those students to graduate. So it wasn't just bringing them in, but helping them to graduate. And we started with the Minority Programs Office, which was successful. And after the 5-year run, the Knight Foundation decided to make it a permanent endowment. And from that point on, we had the Minorities Programs Office. Then we had the Scholarship Placement Center, which was run at that time by the late Helen Aller. And when Helen started having some health issues, again, I was asked if I was interested in becoming the director of the entire program and not just the Minority Programs mm-hmm. Office. So I was happy to do that. And from there, we created the Knight Division for Scholarships, Career Services, and Multicultural Affairs. And at that time, the Knight Division, I was a coordinator for the college's undergraduate scholarship program. Also with the Career Services component, assisting students with jobs and internships. We actually held our own job fair, which I think now is done by the Career Resource Center. Mm-hmm. But at that time, we had our own fair that we used to run for companies to come in and interview students. And then the last part was the Multicultural Affairs Department, which again was a program of recruitment and retention of minority students. We really needed to go out and make sure students were aware of the opportunities that we had at the University of Florida. In the College of Journalism. So I'd spent pretty much half my time recruiting, because again, it was important for us to guide in the community for students to see who we were, what we have. And again, this is before social media was
right.
where it is now. So again, we did more face-to-face and more interpersonal communications with students mm-hmm. and the parents.
What were some of your biggest challenges and successes in these roles?
Biggest challenge, I would say, really was among some of the students that we were recruiting. Their parents did not have a favorable impression of the University of Florida. Mm-hmm. And many of the parents were sort of fearful of allowing the child to attend the University of Florida. And that's one of the reasons why we had started a summer journalism visitation program where the students and the parents came. We paid for them to stay overnight. They got a chance to meet with professors and sort of get a tour, see what we were instead of the perceptions that were out there in the community. So again, that was probably the biggest challenge. The biggest success, some of the successes I would say is that I was really very happy that the support that I received in the college really made a difference. The Dean, Dean Lowenstein at that time, was very supportive. Dean Diane McFarlane, who I mentioned to you, Dean John Wright, they really believed in what we were trying to do. Also, at that time, there were a lot of faculty members that were really helping out as well. So it wasn't just a one-man operation. It really
right.
was a college-wide effort. To me, one of the most satisfying moments was when I would have parents whose child had came to the college and done well and got a job, they were telling other parents about our program. So I would get a call saying, well, Ms. Smith told me that, you know, you were able to get their child in and do all this, and they were calling. So the parents actually got to the point they were recruiting for us. So it moved from them being very apprehensive about the College of Journalism, the University of Florida in particular, to being very supportive of what we were trying to do.
Was it rewarding to get that positive feedback?
It was very rewarding, and oftentimes it would come when I didn't expect it.
Mm-hmm.
So that was always very exciting to me. Or I get a call saying, you know, again, we didn't have the social media at that time.
Right.
We're getting a call saying, hey, my daughter's interested in journalism. Anything you can do to help out? And I was referred by Ms. Smith and so forth. So, again, it was very satisfying to be able to tell these parents that, yes, when your child comes here, that we're going to be able to support them and they are going to graduate and find jobs in the industry.
It must have felt different and probably nice to be the one getting the calls versus going out and recruiting people.
Yeah, in fact, that's actually how recruiting worked. You know, initially it was going out a lot, but after that, when counselors and parents saw the success that we were having in the college, counselors would call me and say, hey, I've got a student here that's interested in the College of Journalism. And again, so they started doing the recruiting for us. But I believe it's because they really felt that we had a good program, that we were sincere in our efforts. One of the things that I was very important to me was to provide feedback as much as I could, given the laws against sharing too much information about students. But again, I would give them feedback on how the student was doing. The scholarship opportunities we had were very numerous. At that time, we had over $200,000 that we were awarding in scholarships. And again, that's when we started forming student organizations to help with the retention aspect of it.
So you worked at the CJC for nearly 25 years. What motivated you to stay all that time?
Well, you know, it goes back to when I said the opportunity to come back to work at UF. I mean, it was an opportunity because I always had when I was a student here, I had a very enjoyable education. I probably should have studied a lot more, but it was a very enjoyable experience. I did not have any hard feelings or really any bad feelings toward the college or the university. So when I had an opportunity to come back and work, I jumped on it. And then an opportunity to come into the college, you know, again, I thought that was fate. Mm-hmm. And I stayed as long as I did because I believed in the mission that we had of trying to assisting students. I got the support in the college that made the job easy for me because, again, it wasn't a one-man operation. It was the entire college, staff, other students, faculty members that really supported the efforts that we were doing. And it just felt like home. Mm-hmm. Just felt like home.
You said you had fond memories of being a student here. Tell me one of the best memories.
Well, some I can tell and some I can't. One of the things I do remember, there was a class called Ad Campaigns that advertising students take their senior year. And this was an opportunity for us to work as a group. So I was working with a group with some of my classmates, and our client was Cypress Gardens, which is no longer around, in Winter Haven. And we actually got a chance to go and visit there. They paid for the class, entire class, to come there and stay a weekend because they wanted us to see the ski shows and everything they had. But from that opportunity there, I created some friendships that really stuck with me for a long time. Even after I graduated, we stayed friends. But it was that chance to work as a group on a project that we did, and we got an A, which was good. But again, it's just the relationships that were developed. And from that class, it really simulated a ad campaign. We had to do the media planning, the creative part of it. And again, we didn't have the social media, so we were stick people and things along those lines. But again, the opportunity to work as a group, you know, I really felt good about that. And again, we had a good class group. And again, we stayed friends for time after the class.
Mm-hmm. Why was it important to be involved with and president of the Association of Black Faculty and Staff at UF?
Well, I was always involved with ABFS as a member. And when the outgoing president had decided that they were not going to be reelected, and it was someone that had been very positive, very active as a president, I just felt there was a void and there was an opportunity. And one of the things I looked at, you know, in my career is giving back. So it was, you know, my work within the college, I enjoyed because it was my way of giving back to those students who perhaps needed that leg up instead of the handout, mm-hmm. as we talk about. So again, it was an opportunity for me to really play a big role within the university itself. At that time, we had meetings with the president where we would share concerns among faculty as well as other staff members. So again, it was an opportunity to give back and to play a bigger role and not just stay in my cocoon of the college itself, but try to have a bigger impact with the entire university.
Additionally, why are groups like UF NABJ valuable?
Okay, when I first came into the college, we had a student organization called Association of Black Communicators, and that was the group before UF NABJ. But UF NABJ became a student affiliate of the National Association of Black Journalists. We actually created more organizations besides UF NABJ. We actually created Hispanic Communicators Association and also the Asian American Student Association as well. And these groups were affiliated with the national organizations with an opportunity to attend the national conference, to see folks who look like them, to understand how you don't work in a vacuum, but understanding how to work with others as well. So it wasn't just, you know, you see a black face here and you take that as far as what your career was. But no, it's learning how to be black and still maintain yourself and work within a group setting and work with other folks to be successful.
A lot of your work is surrounded around the idea of giving minorities opportunities. Why, like, what was the inspiration? Did you always feel like that was going to be your career path? What made you want to give those kids those opportunities?
No, I did not think that was going to be my career path at all. I really had no idea what my career path was going to be. But again, as I go back, you know, when I came through, being a first generation college student, not understanding, I remember being in high school and then there was a young man that had went to another school and I was asking about credits. Well, how do you earn credits towards a degree? And just really, I had no idea what it was. And although I was, if I may say, successful in my journey, I realized that there were a lot of students that did not have that opportunity. And again, it goes back to what I said earlier. It wasn't a handout, it was a hand up. Just an opportunity to say, here, you know, UF has a great program. UF is producing, UF is graduating students. These students are getting jobs in the field. So if this is a area that you're interested in, then this is what UF has to offer you. And as I said earlier too, we initially, when I came in, received a lot of support from major newspapers. Gannett Foundation was a big supporter of us, but a lot of news organizations were really trying to increase the number of minority hires. And they were into diversity. And again, this was based on a study I think came out in 1980 that American Society of Newspaper Editors had created, where they said that we were changing as a country. And based on that, ASNE, along with other organizations, decided that they needed to make a change. They needed to have people who looked like the people that are doing reporting that could go in and talk to these families. In fact, our first black professor in the college, Les Carson, was hired. He actually worked with the riots in the 60s. He was a reporter for a major newspaper. And again, from that experience, he was able to come into the college and tell students about not only his career path, but also encourage them as well. So again, it was all about providing these students with some opportunities that perhaps they were unaware of or because of circumstances just did not know existed.
You received the honor of Professor Emeritus from the College of Journalism and Communications. What does this mean to you?
It means so much to me. I was quite honestly surprised. I wasn't aware that I had received that until I went over to get my UFID. And that's when he told me that I had status there. But it means so much to me because, you know, I came into the college, I had a bachelor's degree. I was an assistant in position, which was a non-tenure earning faculty position where not many folks in that position were able to achieve the status that I achieved. But again, I think it was because of the success that we had as a college. At the height of our success, the college was 25% minority students. So one out of every four students was a minority member in the college. When I started, we were about 8%. So again, we had done a lot of great work. And my work started with the minority programs, but then it expanded to working with all students. I was actually an honor guard at graduation as well. So again, I feel that it was because of the work and accomplishments that we had. But it's something that I will always cherish. It's one of my greatest achievements in life, and one, again, that really meant a lot to me. And the college held a retirement party for me. And I'm not a man that's moved to tears often, but at the time when folks got up and spoke, students and faculty, and spoke about the work that we were doing in the college, I mean, it actually brought a tear to me. Tear to my eyes, but again, it was because of the success that we had. So again, even though I received Professor Emeritus status, it was because of the work that we all did in the college.
In 2013, you left UF to become the CEO of the Central Florida Community Action Agency. How does this organization work to impact the community?
Good question, Alex. I actually started as a member of the board of directors. At that time, the University of Florida had a presidential appointee to the board of directors for Central Florida Community Action Agency. And I served in that position for over 20 years as a board member, serving as board chair, treasurer, every position within the board. And in 2013, The previous CEO at that time was having some health problems. And again, goes back to sort of my life projection here is that I was asked if I was interested in the position. I did not have to apply for it. And I was actually in the drop program within the university system. So I was going to have to exit the college in 2015, but this opportunity came along. And again, because I was so familiar in serving as a board member on behalf of the university, this was an opportunity that was provided for me. Central Florida Community Action Agency is a nonprofit that receives federal funds to assist low-income residents. One program is the Low-Income Home Energy Assistance Program, where they pay utility bills for low-income residents, assisting them with the payment of the bills. One was the Weatherization Assistance Program, where we went into homes and weatherized those homes, mainly for elderly clients to make their homes more safe and secure for them. But the biggest core program was the self-sufficiency program. We were able to provide them with paying for their uniforms, for their educational pursuits, childcare, whatever they needed so that they could focus on getting out of poverty and staying out of poverty. And that was probably one of our most successful programs. And we had many clients that came through. And one client in particular, I remember the family, they came to us, they were making like $14,000 a year. But after the husband and the wife went through our program, they secured better jobs, the family income moved to $50,000.
Oh, wow.
So it really was a big change for that family. And again, it was a way of me continuing to help folks. And as I used to say, I went from helping students to helping the everyday person out there. So again, there's a program that there's 1,000 community action agencies across the country. Not many people are very familiar with them, but they do receive federal funds and state funds to, again, help low-income individuals.
After being at UF for so long, was this transition difficult to a new career? And what did your day-to-day look like?
Yes, it was quite a transition from working in a college environment to working under a board of directors that we had. I was, again, a member of the board of directors, but having to work under a board of directors. And again, the biggest change to me was that the life situations were a little bit more critical, because we'd have folks that came to us that were living out of the car, or their house had got burned, or abusive, having abuse. So the problems change a little bit. And I also had a staff of about 25 folks that worked up under me. So it changed a little bit. When I was in the college, I had one full-time assistant, and we had a lot of student helpers, student assistants that worked in the night division office. But having to supervise over 25 people, and again, it changed because I was a big part of their lives, you know, and I always had to be on call. You know, if someone was sick or something happened to them, it kind of changed a little bit, but I felt that I was successful in the transition. But again, it was a transition from working with students to working with folks who are in crisis.
What was the most gratifying part of leading the CFCAA?
Working with the staff, creating programs. We created a program called Aging in Place, where we would go into the homes of seniors and put in accommodations for them to make their home safer, like grab bars or recessed lighting or redoing their bathroom, putting in a shower type of thing. And that was really, because it was only seniors that we worked with, but that was very satisfying. And the letters that we would get, the thanks that we would get from those seniors who now at one time thinking that they may not be able to live in their home or stay in their home, were able to stay in their home and be safe. So that's one program that we created. There were some other opportunities that we created along the way. We created a program for young kids, and the program is called Rise. And it was a program that where we did case management for the entire family. So if a mother, a single parent, or parents came to us, then we were able to work with their kids, put their kids in tutorial programs, or get them into summer programs, educational programs. We really focused on STEM programs at that time, because we wanted these kids to be exposed, and it was a lot of career exploration we did with them. But the program worked with not only the parents, but the kids as well. So it was a whole family approach to sort of getting the family out of poverty and helping them to stay out of poverty.
Are there communication skills that you learned in college that have proven vital throughout your career?
Well, you know, when I started working as a recruiter, there was a lot of public speaking involved. And at one time, I was so terrified of public speaking that I would have notes and I would still be fiddling and messing up when I was there. But the more I did, the more comfortable I became, the more comfortable you come with the content of what you're discussing. It makes you more comfortable, so you're able to go ahead and pursue that. So, and then initially in my position, the old advertising skills came back when we created new brochures. And again, looking at what type of information that we need in this brochure that people need to know about. So a lot of the programs that we created, our website, was part of what I did. And public speaking, again, just really the interpersonal skills of working with a board of directors, which mean I went from one boss, which is the dean of the college, to 15 bosses on the board of directors, and making sure that you're able to work successfully with everyone. So again, it did change quite a bit, but again, I relied a lot on the skills that I obtained in the College of Journalism, which have never left me. My wife was always asking me to edit her work now and things like that, so I still got an eye for that, I think. But again, those skills, they never leave you.
Do you have any advice to our audience when it comes to finding a career that you're truly passionate about?
I would say, one of the things that I would always talk about when I was a student was really pursue your passion. Oftentimes kids are looking at positions and looking at the dollar value of those positions. But again, you need to follow your passion. I used to say, if you really work hard, if there's something that you really enjoy, the finances will come. It may not come right away, but again, be patient, but you will see success as long as you're being the best that you can in your job. But again, don't look at the dollar value, dollar figure associated with that position, but look at where that position can take you. And I think one of the other things I think is important is not look at jobs, but look at careers. Oftentimes kids want a job, but when you look at yourself and look at position that you're in, see, is this something that I want as a career? Is this something that I feel that I can do for, like I did, 20 years or more, or is this just a job? I think you'll find more satisfaction if you look at it from a career viewpoint rather than just, I'm getting a job.
Thank you for your insight, Charles.
Thank you, Alex. I enjoyed it.
And thank you to our viewers for joining us. Until next time, good night.